they are the best association. And socially, it wasn't the work, but social activity. He organized a lot of kind of events, trips, or even pilgrimages for these people. He has the knowledge and experience how to negotiate the prices, how to obtain the grants, sponsors, and the other opportunities of funding for example, trips for poor, lonely, sick, or disabled people. What's more, the activity will develop the localization is in the countryside. It's not far from Rano. And why, as I said previously, why is he competitive to the other companies? Because these are the unique travel services tailored to the health and financial capacities of customers. What is going to sell trips, pilgrimages to the culture and heritage places and tours and guide services. It's about me now. And the next person is Aneta, but we don't have the PowerPoint, but there is the poster of Aneta. Aneta also lives in a different place in the countryside of close to Radom. She's going to start the agriculture and spa farm. We say shelter for pilgrim. Why? Because the localization is close to the pilgrimages roads. She has experience to host them, and she would like to start such activities. She has a bachelor degree in physiotherapy, so she would like to link the resting in her at her farm together with medical help. For example, old people need some medical help. She can do it during their stay. What can we say more about Anna? So, object is organization of accommodation for tourists and pilgrims from Poland and abroad. The target customers, pilgrims, families looking for the peaceful holidays, elderly and disabled people needing some medical treatment, and the other people of course are open. Why she will be competitive? Because, again, these services are unique. The prices are low because she will use the local food and local transport methods to help her. And what kind of products and services she's going to sell? Of course, accommodation, pool, board, fresh homemade food, short trips to the cultural heritage and thermal spa places which are in the area. And as I said, physiotherapeutic treatment services. I think it's really interesting and unique for Polish customers. I don't know if the customers from abroad will be interested, but would be that. Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Catherine. So as I understood well, you are not going to present your project. It's just what Catherine told us. I'm right? Am I right? Catherine? Yes. Okay. It seems that it looks like Catherine presented their ideas. Well, we are going to the next section, but before I would like to summarize very briefly what has been said in a sentence. I promise not to be talking for half an hour. So, as far as I understood, most of you plan to develop ideas in emergent tourism destinations. Okay? Some of your ideas are thought to complement the actual tourism supply at the destinations. So maybe a cape shop, a tavern, a new accommodation, something like that are the things you are thinking about, okay? Very important, and I will be insisting on that idea across the next year, is to think about our potential customers, okay? Why we are going to offer them something that is different and why they are going to prefer us to the other competitors, okay? This is very important to remain, to keep in mind. Another very important thing, okay, is the need to keep attention into the market, to keep an eye into the market, and the different ideas you presented, some of them are more developed, others are more draft ideas, okay? But the most important thing is that you want to do something. And you need to be open to rethink about your ideas and maybe to change completely what you wanted to do, okay? So, for instance, sorry if I'm talking something that for you is stupid because you know better your project and I'm telling something that is rubbish. Sorry for that, but for instance, for me it's very difficult to think about succeeding in a destination that has not good assets by road or accessibility at the destination is very difficult. So making investments in the destination to run a business where people cannot go, really go, is difficult. It's difficult to make a business model on that base. So maybe you may think about traveling on helicopter and jumping with, okay? You need to rethink about your ideas to make it plausible, okay? To make them more realistic, okay? So for the next year, what I advise you to do is to rethink about the ideas in order to make it the most close to reality as possible and to differentiate your value proposition from other competitors. Now we are going to have a session in which different experts are going to advise you, and for me it's very important strategic marketing, and we will talk about this and others on the rest of the evening. So this is everything I may say at the moment, and just I leave the next presenter to introduce the next speaker. Thank you so much for your presentations.
I just come up with Ana Hernandez as a translator to ensure that you understand. And I wanted to do just an advertisement. We have an USB lost with a very peculiar form of cork. It's like a wine bottle tap. Okay. So if anybody, it's already. Like that one, okay? It's a Rebollos USB. So if anyone find it, please tell us or give us. Okay, we start the next panel.
Pero ahí te vas a tener que sentar, vas a tener que dejar al que vaya a presentar, ¿no? Porque quieres ahí mejor. Buenas tardes. Vamos a iniciar la segunda mesa. Vamos a empezar con David y con... Vale. Tenemos a David Ward y Gizem Tüdes. Ellos son expertos en desarrollo y destinos turísticos. En los últimos 10 años han trabajado en más de 50 proyectos turísticos, ¿no? Trabajando precisamente con la Fundación Nacional de Reino Unido, con organizaciones internacionales como la OMT o como también la Comisión Europea. ¿No se oye nada? Ah, perdón.
It's already founded the USB, and just to say in English what Anna said, we have chance, the luck to be to have here David Ward-Perkins. He's a consultant with years of experience and lots of projects in the tourist field. So we are also very expecting what he has to tell us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good afternoon. Do I have my presentation?
You do.
Just on there, yes.
It's en, está en el escritorio.
Panel one, I think. Okay, while they are finding my presentation, I just want to tell you that on my way here, I lost my glasses. So I've got sunglasses, which I have lenses in. So I have a choice. I can either put the sunglasses on, and I see you very clear, but it looks like it's the middle of the night. Or else I can look like this, and it looks very fuzzy. And so I'll probably be putting them on and off as we talk. Through the presentation. Good. Okay, I'm going to talk here briefly about transnational tourism routes and looking at the pan-European picture. And you'll understand in a moment why I'm talking about this subject. Can you, the next slide. Can I tell you what
you're
going to do? Sí, yo voy pasando.
Yes, the arrow. No. Okay, that's good.
Sí.
Right. So. I worked on this with Gizem Tüdes, who's sitting here in the front row. My company is called David Ward-Perkins and Associates, very logically. We work on a marketing consultancy for the tourism industry, and particularly the development of cultural sites, a lot of it in rural areas. It's a lot of it to do with development of economic and social facilities in rural areas. And recently, in the last 2 or 3 years, more and more on transnational tourism projects. Okay, and specifically, the reason I'm going to be talking about it today is that with a group called Team Tourism, I've been directing a project on the handbook on the marketing of transnational themes and routes. This was commissioned by the UNWTO and by the European Travel Commission. And we're coming to the end of it. The delivery is at the end of this month, and I need to give you some of the conclusions that are coming out of this study. The first thing, just as a general background, is that we identified 5 central drivers of travel. As I say, to be able to talk at a European level, we had to have a sort of a basic structure at the back. And so we said, are all transnational projects valid? And we said, no, we don't think so. We think there are different types of drivers. One of them is simply necessity, like the Syrian immigrants that are coming at the moment. One of them is to do with economic gain, and economic gain includes things like business tourism. If you go to a place because economically it's interesting for you, or you travel to a place because you have a job, or whatever it is. Then hedonism, which would include things like I'm very tired, I want to go to a place which is restful, or I like to lie on the beach and enjoy the sun, or whatever. Aspiration, which is the big one that we're going to look at this afternoon, and aspiration is the instinct that all human beings have to learn, to acquire, to experience new things. And I think this is something in tourism, something that aspiration is being rediscovered at the moment. I say for a long time, there was a sort of a sense that there is this mass tourism, and that really all the mass tourists want to do is they want to see the big monuments, they want to go to the beach and all the rest of it. And there was a realization that actually the majority of people do want experiences, they do want to learn things and so on. And that's the primary driver behind that aspiration. And then the last one is challenge, which is things like I want to bicycle across the Alps, or I want to walk across the desert, which is, I'm great to do this. And these are not boxes. You don't sit in one box or another. It's a mix of drivers that influence things. But the central one, no doubt about it, as far as we're concerned, is the aspiration. Okay. Put on my glasses. I don't know if you can read this, but what we did was we grouped the different types of themes. We put them into general groupings. And I'm just going to identify a few of the most important ones. There's history, which is to do with understanding the past. There's a pilgrimage, which is experiencing or sensing a sense of spirituality or sublimation through travel. There are things, roots, which are discovering and experiencing the heritage of one's ancestors or one's peoples. There's landscape, there are natural systems, there are cultural icons, there are urban life, which is participating in the lives of cities. There is rural life, which is participating in the life of rural areas. Maritime life, artistic excellence, traditional crafts, food and drink, which, as you all know, is sort of a massive driver, physical challenge, industrial tourism, and well-being. And well-being is an interesting one because it includes the whole historical element, but it also includes things which have to do with personal pleasure and enjoyment. Okay. So what I want to talk about now a little bit, when we were doing the study, we started doing this, and we did a database, and we identified 130 transnational projects, transnational themed projects. And when we looked at those 130, we found that maybe 90, a massive majority, were called roots. And so we said, well, we better understand what this thing roots is. So, first of all, just a little bit of basic thinking. We sort of said, well, what is a root? And so you can start with something like this. These are the travels of Ibn Battuta in the 14th century of our era. And he traveled as far as China and down into Africa and all the rest of it. And he was taking a route. But it wasn't a route that was necessarily going to be followed by anyone else. This was his route. Then you move on and you come into the 18th century. In the 18th century, the time of the Grand Tour, and the nations of Northern Europe who were coming down very mostly to Italy, Italy or Greece, to discover the heritage which they felt was theirs. And here, the roots started to become more formalized. People would talk to each other. They would say, this is the way I went. These are the towns that you need to see. This is obligatory. This you have to do, and all the rest of it. And so it began to establish a kind of convention around what it is that you can see. Jumping ahead into the 20th century, towards the end of the 20th century, there was the big discovery by tourism of the concept of a route. And the basic idea is very simple, is that I have an asset, which is on a common theme. In this particular example, it's wine. And if I wanted to tell people about it, it's much clearer if I show them something like a map, and people can say, oh yes, I can see that these places are close to each other. And people discovered very quickly that the traveller does not necessarily go to the places in that particular order, but it is an interesting promotional tool. And people actually discovered, if you look at the one on the right, the one on the left is in Alsace in France, the one on the right is in South Africa, in the Stellenbosch area, and very, very quickly, they didn't even bother to mark the particular itinerary which you put on it, because they realized that the behavior of people in these things was that they'd look at the different wine routes against their vineyards, and they'd say, oh, I think I'll go to this one, here, looking at it transnationally, this is Chocolate Way, and on the left-hand side, you can see the map that they developed very early in the project. And they've made a big effort to make a trace. You go from here to here to here to here to here to here. And clearly, you can see the thinking. They're thinking, this is a route, therefore we need to have an itinerary. The reality of the Chocolate Way is what you have on the right. The Chocolate Way is not an itinerary. The Chocolate Way is a network. It's a network of different places which have a common theme. Okay? And when you looked at the different types of routes, that is one of the big categories of routes, is routes which are, in fact, networks. And from a linguistic point of view, it would be much clearer to call it a chocolate network. But it doesn't sound so good. It sounds nicer if it's a chocolate route. Okay? Here we have an excellent example that my friend Martin knows extremely well, which is the Historic Heritage Town Association, which is essentially a network. That's to say, the requirement of the customer is not that you go first to one and then to the next and then to the next. The requirement of them is that you understand that there is this range of offer and that you can go to the ones that interest you and that each promotes the other and it creates something which is powerful as a totality. And here's another one which both functions in the same sort of way, which is the Federation of Napoleonic Cities, which has also become Destination Napoleon. And these are all cities, they call it cities, most of them small towns. And the towns have a historic heritage which is to do with Napoleon, and they link up, it's very successful. There are 50 small towns which have signed on up till now, and quite a lot of new candidates which are coming along. And why are they so interested? Why do they want to join this so much? Okay, so we'll move on to the next slide. And it asks, what's the interest and what's the purpose of the network? And there are three big ones. You could make a long list, but I see three really big ones. One which is simply to federate expertise. If I am a small town, in my municipality, I don't have the experts working there. I don't have the people who are capable of doing good social media marketing. I don't have people who understand branding locally, and so on. So there's the federation of expertise. Secondly, to federate resources, that's to say, if there are 50 of us, and each of the 50 put in 500 euros, we can probably have a stand at ITB, or at the World Travel Market, or at Vitor, or something like that. There is a capacity to do things on a large scale which we wouldn't have locally. And then the third one, which is very important, which is providing access to the global marketplace. If you want to work, for example, with large tour operators, they're not going to come to you if you're a small town, but if you are the Federation of Napoleonic Cities and you have an interesting offer to do it, then you can talk to them, you can develop products, and so on. So there is a very strong commercial requirement for this in the interest of the network. Okay, moving on. Here's another interesting, it's an old version, here's an interesting one, which is the Buddhist circuit. This particular map that we can see here is a cycling trail, but actually what the Buddhist circuit is, it's in between Nepal and India. And the Buddhist circuit identifies the key sites in the life of the Buddha, where he was born, where he achieved enlightenment, where he did certain special things, and so on. And so there are in this area something like 6 or 7 big sites, and these big 6 sites are already places of pilgrimage. People go there, and they've linked them up, and they've proposed certain circuits like the cycling thing, but that's not the expectation. The expectation is that they can talk now to the tour operators, and the tour operators have the material to be able to develop products which are intelligent products, not just I take 20 people and take them to the site and they look at it and look, we go on somewhere else. There is a content behind it. Okay. The Mekong, a slightly different case. The Mekong River is massively developed for tourism, through private enterprise. All sorts of tour operators have Mekong tours. You go to the bottom, particularly the Mekong Delta area, you can get boats, you can go up there, and so on. And it's the tourism is seriously imbalanced. And so the Mekong, this is the, what do you remember what they're called, the organization? So the Mekong sub-region, the Greater Mekong sub-region or something like that. They have a tourism strategy, and the purpose of the tourism strategy is to develop tourism on a wider scale to use other rivers which are there, the tributaries of the Mekong, to spread the tourism, and also to work with local communities on community-based tourism. Okay, next. Thank you. So, I thought, since because of the theme of this, I think I thought I should talk a little bit about roots and pilgrimage, where does sort of pilgrimage fit into all of this? Next. Here is a specific example. This is close to where I live, which is in the southern Alps. It's the Madonna de la Fenestre, and they have a pilgrimage once a year. And this is pilgrimage, referring back to, I think it was Martine that talked about it this morning. This is a pilgrimage where it is the walking that is important. That's to say, you start down in the valley, in the place of the nearest town, and you walk. It's something like a 10-kilometer walk. And the important thing is doing the walk. Getting there is nice, you've got a wonderful view, and all the rest of it, but the important thing is doing the walk. Okay, here is Clonmacnoise in Ireland, and Clonmacnoise is one of the big monasteries in the Celtic period. That's to say, the period from the 7th to the 8th centuries. And Clonmacnoise was definitely a pilgrimage site, but it was a central cluster. That's to say, people came, there wasn't a specific route. People came from every direction to Clonmacnoise because there were specific times of the year, big important events that happened. Okay, here is a different model completely for anyone who has ever read Chaucer, the Canterbury Tales. It's very clear when you read the Canterbury Tales that the interest of the Canterbury Tales is a social occasion. People would travel from London to Canterbury, which is not a very long distance. And the purpose was you traveled in groups, you talked to people, you exchanged, and then you arrived at Canterbury, where there was the tomb of Thomas a Becket. And here's a different one again, which is pilgrimage and trade in the Arabian Peninsula. Unfortunately, a lot of these trade routes have disappeared, that would be a very interesting project for the future. To be able to work on the resurrection of these. And it is very clear when you read about Arabian Peninsula in the sort of 5th to 10th century of our era, that there was no distinction made between the concept of trade and pilgrimage, just that they had the big routes across the desert, and they were trade routes, people carried them, and then this is how the pilgrims went to, after the time of the Muslim era, how the pilgrims went to Medina and to Mecca. And that brings us on to the concept of experience. Experience which is central, and why is this important for us in pilgrimage? Because obviously walking is a personal experience. It's hard work. You know you're doing it yourself, okay? And we know from other types of studies and all the rest of it that the experiential nature of travel is becoming more and more important, and there are more and more products being developed, and there's more and more interest. And this, which was 10 years ago, these kinds of products, which were niche products, are now becoming becoming mainstream, in particular in places like Southeast Asia. Okay, I'll jump from that. That's not really our subject. And coming back to the specific relation to pilgrimage, let's move on. What I want to say, this is sort of my conclusion of the presentation, is that I've shown you a different number of examples, and what struck us when we were looking at the different types of pilgrimage examples is how different the models are, one from the other. There are some things in common. There is this concept of aspiration, there is this concept often of spirituality, but definitely a concept of spirituality. There is a concept that spirituality is something that is shared, that is social, that is local, that people, that everybody can get involved in. It's very inclusive, generally speaking. But today, I think there are a certain number of stereotypes, and the route of Santiago de Compostela is, for pilgrimage tourism, a wonderful thing because it has raised the profile of tourism. It is every tourism authority in Europe is saying, we would like our route, our pilgrimage route. Let me tell you, I work with a lot of them. I cannot tell you any single one tourism authority that I've spoken to who has not said to me, wouldn't it be nice if we had a pilgrimage route? They all want them. Okay, and why do they want them? It's because they look at St. James's Compostela and they say, wow, look at all those people. We'd like those people. Okay? So so that's great, it's raised the profile of it. The negative side of it is that everybody thinks that it all has to be like St. James of Compostela. And I've heard people say that actually St. James of Compostela has got it right. Every pilgrimage route should do it the way St. James of Compostela does it. And I say, no, absolutely not. You should look at what you've got and you should develop it according to what it is and how it should operate. So I'm going to give you just a few quick examples here. We'll just go through them and let's go to the next one. Here's one which is not so different from James of Compostela, but it is different anyway. I was speaking to some people at lunch over this one. This is St. Olaf Ways, and I spent a wonderful 4 days in Norway in May walking on the St. Olaf Ways, and it is very, very spectacular, very, very impressive. It is supported by the Norwegian government, but more important, it is supported by the local communities, and the local communities take direct and total responsibility about the parts that go near them, about the hostels that are on there, about the signage, and they take responsibility also on the walkers. If a walker arrives and the weather is bad and they're expected and they haven't turned up, then what does the person at the hostel do? He puts on his boots and his coat and he goes out along the path and he looks for the person. There is a strong sense of ownership. Okay, so moving on. Paradigms, Via Francigena. This is something I was talking to, I can't remember his name.
Francesco
at lunch about this. What strikes me about the Via Francigena is that it was the Via Francigena and now it's becoming the Via Francigena. And there is an extension. It's been very successful. It has a grassroots element. We have local authorities, which is very interesting. There's been a lot of local support and all the rest of it. And there is a realization that this is a major brand, and it is interesting to add pieces to it. And I think, Francesco, I may be wrong, but I think if we go back to this in 10 years' time, even north of Rome, there will be several near Francesco. Here is a different one, which is Bangor, Northern Ireland. In Bangor, Northern Ireland, for St. Columbanus, it's a pilgrimage site which is growing very, very quickly. And they've set up a thing called the Meditation Trail. And there are Columbanus sites now throughout Europe, which are creating a walking route, is secondary. The primary idea is when I go to the Romana site, I will find a meditation trail. A meditation trail means I walk around an area which is in some way evocative of St. Columbanus. And whether I am Christian or not, or whatever it is, it's of little importance. It's getting in contact, having an experience.
Yeah.
Okay, and here's another example, which is Festival of Masks in Senegal. In Senegal, there are festivals which for me very clearly are pilgrimages, because every year festival is held, every year people come and often they come on foot, very long distances across frontiers to come to these festivals. And festivals are held in different places every year. So it's not to do with the place. it's to do with the event. Okay, so, and that's just a little, very, very quick outline that I've given you. And we see other models. We see models that are based on sort of clustering basis. We've seen models which are circuits. We've seen many other different types of models. Basically, the thing I wanted to say, that's the sort of the conclusion of what I have to say, is don't get stuck in stereotype of what a pilgrimage route needs to be. You need to look at the territory, you need to look at the people, you need to look at the motivation of the people who are walking. Who are these people? Why are they doing it? What is it they're looking for? And you build it around the people, not around the idea that somebody else in some other country, in some other circumstances, has done it maybe the same way, maybe a different way. And if there is best practice, that's good, but best practice needs to be contextual and it needs to be local, because that's what tourism is all about. And so, and there is an infinite range of potential for restoration in tourism. Okay, thank you very much.
¿Las preguntas para después o hay después? ¿Alguna cuestión? ¿No? Pues, thank you. Bien. A continuación tenemos con nosotros a Lidia Andrades. Ella es profesora del área de comercialización e investigación de mercados en la Facultad de Ciencias Económicas y Empresariales de la Universidad de Extremadura.
Following Lidia Andrades, expert in marketing research of the University
15 minutos, of Extremadura. 15 minutos, por favor.
Okay, well, I was smiling why David was presenting, because we have been working together in one of the projects he has been involved with Russia over the last years, and somehow my presentation has the same structure. Of course, it's different, but we have been thinking together about the tourist experience and how to develop tourism products, okay? Well, the aim of this presentation is just to provide you with some tips about what you think you need to think about before developing tourism products, okay? So we will think about, first of all, the market. So, first thing is to understand tourist longings and tourist expectations, okay? What they are looking for, and it's not always easy to find out what people need, because for us, sometimes it's difficult to understand ourselves and to know what we need. So to understand others is even more difficult. We will think about cultural tourism experiences at the destination and key success factors to design tourism products. For me, something I don't believe is that you may design a tourism product that is good for everybody. For all the social class, for all the age, not for everybody. We have to think about specific needs at a specific market, as for instance we have been talking about disabled people, okay? And design something that matches their interests. So, what is the cultural tourist experience? Well, cultural tourist experience means first that tourists need to participate. It's not something that you is like sitting in the sofa and you watch TV. No, you need to interact with the service provider to make sure that the experience is something different and deep and memorable, okay? Of course, you participate and you interact in a special atmosphere, that is the cultural resources at the destination. And this interaction should give you meaning, okay? And should allow allows you, excite you, motivate you, okay? That is the experience. And now we will think about who are our customers, how to motivate them, what they are, what attribute they are looking for. For instance, if I am traveling with the family, I will look for a recommendation in which I have a grip for my little child. Or if I'm traveling with my parents, maybe I expect a destination where I may find place in the world sorry for my English. But I mean, if you are going in a place that is difficult to work, you need to grab something to them for them. So if it is for old people, you have to think about the need of these old people, okay? So different segments have different needs, and we need to reflect about the people we want to attract, what they need, what is important for them. So thinking about the market segmentation, classic variables to segment markets, nationality, that is not something obvious. I think there is a presentation today about Halal tourism, okay? For instance, if we are targeting China, we need to think that Chinese people are, many of them are allergic to lactosa, that is something that is in the milk. If in a Spanish diet, in the way we cook, we introduce milk, we can be pretty sure that the Chinese people, when try, when taste or delicious food, are going to be getting milk and to have stomach ache. So every culture we want to attend, we need to think about their needs and their customs, etc. Okay? I separate the general demographic profile from companies and organizations because it's something important to think about is sustainability in tourism. It's easy that you have a high demand during the weekends or in summer holidays, etc. But what you are going to do the rest of the year, markets for different seasons across the year. So possibly during the week you may attract business people, incentive travel, for instance, for companies. If you are selling a deep experience destination and a special place, okay, you may sell this to businesses as the way to team building activity, to make operate the people that is working in the company in the same team. So if they go and share an experience at a destination, maybe they know better each other and they will work more efficiently together. Okay? So it's important to think about flow management at the destination. And important to think about when different kind of tourists are may attract at different stage of the year or of the week. Well, so classic variables for segmenting market like age, sex, social class, etc. are not as good as these kind of variables like most of the world, life and leisure, personal values, power brand fundamentals, social networks. Which networks do we use? Because in Spain, Facebook, Instagram, but if we move to another country, they are not familiar maybe with the same. We think they should be familiar with the same we use, but not. LinkedIn is a professional network in Spain and in Europe, but maybe in Eastern Europe or in Russia, they use other different, I don't remember the name, but they use different ones. So we need to be aware about that. We even need to be aware about where are we to promote our services. Here in Extremadura, there was a special course for entrepreneurs, not in tourism. In general, people who sell agricultural products to other countries, okay? And they were people who were developing websites to sell cured yam and other things in China. And put it a nice website in English and so on. This doesn't work if you are not using in China a special provider, internet provider. Because in China, there is, help me, that's the government control what you check in Google. So is censura in Spanish, sorry for that, but
censorship.
So if you have a website in a Spanish provider or European one, possibly in China, they cannot see your website. It happens to us that we organized in Cáceres last September an international conference, and people from China were coming, okay? And I was feeling that they were not serious because they were making the registration process, and then they were not answering for 2 weeks, and then they were again trying to check something. And finally I found out with the meter parade they have there, the government cut the access to internet in 2 weeks. So, important, if we are going to host international tourists, important to understand the market. In the different stage of the developing of the tourism product, is before the tourist is coming to the destination, we need to be present at those websites, at those media, that they can be in touch with us. And not necessarily at the same in the different countries. You need the speeding of the destination, you need to make sure that you are adapting your service to their special needs, okay? So, according to these variables that helps better to understand tourists, we can establish different tourist segments based upon if they are more risk takers or adventurers or conservative. Behind these words, you have a very academic classification about tourist motivation, behavior, etc. That is going from a continuum on the top of the slide, from tourists that are less active to more active tourists, from tourists that are more conservative to tourists that are more willing to take risk, etc. This is a segmentation made by a European consultant company, GSK, and they, based upon different questions, they classify tourists. How much I have?
Okay.
I was scared. Okay, I still have time. So they classify European people in dreamers, adventurers, open-minded, settlers, demanding. Those different segments need different things, are make decisions and choose destinations based upon different criteria. And it's important to understand that. Summarizing the previous slide, if we combine our values, our interests, and how we spend our leisure time, how we consume the media we use, can we say that we may be classified into people that need to be, or people that need to have? People that seek for living a passionate life, and people who seek for peace and security. And depending on that, we will choose different products. Well, is there more of this reason, so I move forward. There we have the same like GSK, that is a private company, from the university point of view, in fact from University of New Zealand, of Otago, New Zealand. There you cannot classify people depending on people who wants to be or people who wants to be coming. This is very interesting for a cultural point of view, because choosing one of your companies to visit the destination may mean for people that they are growing as a personal being, as a human being. It's like a process that you go to the destination, you experience the destination, and the person that comes back is not the same that the person that arrived at the destination, because has learned something new, because has interacted with other people, okay? This is a lot about the religious experience. Not necessarily I must be religious to be keen on becoming a better person and growing, okay? So, we may lead tourists and go with the tourists and offer them chances across their visit to the destination to enhance their experience and to grow. So what is a memorable experience? If we are talking about the experience, we need to think about anticipation. When I'm planning the trip before going to the destination, while I'm in the destination, and when I back, the speeding is the whole time, okay? So we need to think our companies, how may go with the tourists from the beginning until the end, okay? So which are the ingredients of a memorable experience, of the experience that somehow changed me? Okay. First thing is to understand that tourism is tangible and intangible. Let's see, for instance here, according to the speed, different resources that may be the base upon which we may develop tourism products, like heritage, urban or cities, rural cultural tourism, indigenous, okay? These are the things that came to our mind when thinking about cultural tourism. But also, it is art tourism, creative tourism, okay? Another kind of tourism. This picture is from Lisbon, okay? I have a PhD student from Peniche, Lidia Institute, or Polytechnic Institute, okay? And she performed a very interesting study that was awarded in the European Union, analyzing the artificial images of Lisbon. She was, with a software, she was checking all the pictures that tourists upload to Instagram about Lisbon and comparing those pictures with the official answers, and she discovered that the street art, okay, like this one, was one of the things that tourists were uploading more than everything, than anything in Instagram. So for tourists, are even more important this than museums, monuments, etc. in Lisbon, okay? So we need to find out what is interesting for tourists that not necessarily is that official heritage, okay? So we may think about intangible resources to develop tourism product. Now we need to design, okay? And we need to be creative, and I would like to speak to you. I think he was a wise man, and I think it's very interesting what he told about creativity as something that means connecting ideas. What is creating something new? Sometimes it's not very different from what we know already. It's just the creation, it's just connecting something that is unconnected, that you put all together and becomes incredible. So, everybody knows about the filming things, and we have Panama telling us, I can record your story during the visit of the destination, and this can be very different for you because you will live your experience at the destination in a different way. Or, there are already many services for tourists in this destination, but no one that is targeting disabled people. Why not? Why not I can adapt the destination or my company and provide experiences to disabled people? So creativity is about connecting ideas. Well, the starting point, okay, tourism services are products that people would like to acquire, enjoy and pay for. Important. There is no possibility to develop any business if people is not going to pay us, to give us money for doing things. Sustainable tourism is very important, but sustainability means four things. First, economic sustainability. If you cannot make profits from your activity, you better think about another activity. Okay? Second is preserving the resources. Sustainable environmental sustainability. Because if you are not preserving the resources, you can make business today, but tomorrow you will not have business because you have not resources. Okay? Then you have a very important thing that rise here before this morning when people were presenting, that is that a social sustainability. That means that you have to how to explain that? Tourism development has many impact over society. And in general, sometimes local people may not enjoy having the development of the tourism activity. If you are a restaurant, of course you want to have more and more tourists at the city, but if you are a local that is not, are not working related to tourism directly, you may not enjoy that many people is coming to your city, okay, very quick. So, social sustainability, involving locals and promoting that local supports the tourism activity is important. But for that, to involve them, okay, you have to make them aware about their resources and make them aware that selling those resources, cultural resources, that not necessarily is a museum, is the story of the city, for instance, is a way to preserve the story and to remind the locals where they are coming from, which is the genetic of the place. Well, I need to move ahead. We will have time over the next year to work together and to think about all of this. Of course, you need an strategic marketing plan, and that means to think about and to solve many questions, envisioning the destination. Something more important for designing tourism product is to manage the interactions between the tourist and the destination. It's not just that you bring the tourist to the destination and the tourist discover the destination alone. You have to manage things to make them go through the places you want to show and at the right time of the day, at the, difficult because I have no time. So, managing the interaction between the tourists of the destination, the tourists are the service provider too, okay? The people who is directly working with the tourists must be nice people, able to understand them. And very important thing, the interaction between tourists, interactions between your customers. Customers that are at your company must have the chance to interact, because that's, that will enhance the spirit they have at the destination. It's different if I'm alone, that if I have the chance to talk with other people that is at the same destination for different reasons, but I can share my experience with others and enhance my spirit. Okay, so I will leave the presentation. You may check, it's just different steps you need to follow to design a cultural tourism product, okay? And finally, I want to conclude, okay? I want to explain something, is that experience, destination means that you have you need to have the feeling that you are growing, that the destination is helping you to experience something different, and for that, it's very important to understand this. Slide. Well, previously we have a slide that was Zaralli is the author of Flow. He's a positive psychology from the University of Chicago, and he defined that flow is the state in which you feel very happy and you lose the awareness about the time because you are enjoying so much what you are living at the moment. Okay? So how we make tourists flow and enjoy? This Csikszentmihalyi theory explains how to flow, you need to challenge and manage the challenge level. So, if we are attracting tourists and we are giving them the chance to do a temporary route that is very hard for them, for their physical conditions, they will feel frustrated and they will not finish the route. Okay, and they will come back home unsatisfied and frustrated. Okay, if you give them the possibility of doing a very easy route, the same. If you are a sport people and you feel very unfit, you will feel bored about doing this very easy. Okay, so you need to adapt the level of challenge to your skills, to the skills of the people that are visiting you. So, you make sure that you are inviting them to do things they can do with the skills they have. So, especially thinking on disabled people, you have been talking about. Disabled people may have in mind that they have many boundaries they cannot cross because of their disability. So how we may bring them to a good experience? We have to give them challenge, at the same time we are supporting them to face the challenge and to succeed. So they will feel they are growing, okay? So it's not only about disabled people, but you always need to think that the challenge you are presenting to your tourists is according to their skills. And if not, you have to teach them, train them, to make sure they are succeeding in facing the challenge, so they are growing, okay? Well, and finally, conclusions, well, just conclusions, a word, because I want, I prefer you to have your own conclusions of my presentation. I'm available in internet and through email if you have any questions, and I will give the presentation to the organizer so they may send it to you. Thank you so much for your attention.
Gracias, Lidia. No. Bueno, ¿alguien tiene alguna cuestión? ¿Alguna pregunta para Lidia Andrades? Bueno, si al final tenemos un poco de tiempo, igual podemos permitir alguna pregunta, ¿no? Bien, pues a continuación va a hacer su presentación Pilar Sánchez González. Ella es licenciada en Ciencias Políticas y Sociología, es experta en cultura islámica y en religión, y sus líneas de investigación se centran en el marketing, en el turismo y en la innovación educativa también. Es autora de varios artículos de revistas internacionales de impacto y así como de capítulos de libros, y ha colaborado también con centros de investigación y con universidades de Francia, Alemania, Italia, incluso hasta Perú. Bueno, muchas gracias, Pilar. Te pido, por favor, los 15 minutitos.
15 minutos, ok. Uh-huh,
para
gracias.
Si quiere alguna pregunta.
Sí, whenever you,
cuando me digas, ok, yo paro cuando quiero que lo traduzcas, ¿vale? Gracias. Bueno, perdón primero porque mi inglés no es ni mucho menos el exigido por el nivel que tenéis y no puedo hablar en inglés. Y ahora casi no hablo ni en castellano. Bueno, buenas tardes. Gracias por la invitación de compartir con vosotros estas jornadas. He aprendido muchísimo y estoy aprendiendo, por supuesto, siempre se aprende, pero en este caso, esta mañana cuando os escuchaba, pensaba en el futuro, ¿no? El futuro que sois todos vosotros y el futuro que tiene que ser rentable. Y cuando ahora me planteo hablaros de un nuevo tipo de cliente, ¿sí? Ah, vale, perdón. Y cuando me planteo hablar de un nuevo tipo de cliente, pues tenemos que hablar de dinero. ¿Qué pasa?
Decime.
Ah, perdón.
Era una cuestión de estética, vale, perdón. Cosas del directo, vale.
Okay. No había quien lo entendiera con esas señas.
Perdón. Vale, ¿sí?
Perdona.
Pilar has started saying that he has learned a lot from this morning presentation, from seeing all your business projects,
Ya, pero que hay una cuestión de rentabilidad, que son proyectos, pero que tienen que ser rentables, tiene que haber clientes.
As well as Lidia highlighted, the good ideas shall bring us to rentability and to viability, sustainability of the business.
Ok. Mi trayectoria es de marketing y trabajo en un centro que nos dedicamos a vender y a estudiar al consumidor. Y me alegro muchísimo de escuchar a compañeros como Lidia y como el compañero inglés, David, okay, porque hablaban de segmento, ¿no? Y mi gran apuesta es hablar de un segmento nuevo, el segmento musulmán. Vamos a hablar de un cliente que tiene una religión. Y todo esto porque parto de un concepto que es el marketing one-to-one. La gente cuando viaja necesita tener una experiencia y esa experiencia es individual.
She's speaking about segmentation and marketing one-to-one. It's very important for this kind of tourists and clients, Muslim tourism, to part from this marketing one-to-one.
Gracias. Hay diferentes tipos de clasificación de turismo. Estas son las que aparecen en la Organización Mundial de Turismo. Yo me he atrevido a incorporar otras, como el sostenible, que habéis hablado de él, el de duelo, el experiencial, el homosexual, con mascotas, con singles, o sea, dirigido para singles, para mujeres. Pero hay una cuestión de base que es que yo parto de una frase de compramos como rezamos. Por lo tanto, viajamos como rezamos.
She has shown the established tourist categories by the
UN, Organización Mundial de Turismo.
UNWTO. And after she has shown another categories, another labels for tourists, like tourists for singles, tourists with pets, or tourists tourism, whatever, there are many new labels and definitions of tourists that she is highlighting a sentence that we pray as we buy, or we buy as we pray, we travel as we pray.
Entonces, si partimos de que compramos como rezamos y viajamos como rezamos, yo apuesto por un cliente que es el musulmán, aquella persona que sigue una religión que es la islámica. ¿Por qué? Por una cuestión de rentabilidad. Cuando en marketing buscamos nuevos nichos de mercado, nuevos negocios, hay datos que son muy esclarecedores. Entonces, ¿cuántos musulmanes hay en el mundo? 1.600 millones.
Now she's presenting some data, very interesting to look at this segment of tourists, Muslim tourists, because we have in the world 1,600 million of people considering themselves Muslim.
Que significan aproximadamente un 25% de la población mundial, ¿vale? Desde luego, la perspectiva es global, es decir, desde que tenemos un negocio, estamos hablando de un mercado internacional. Y tiene una previsión de, algunos estudios dicen, por ejemplo, que en el año 2020 el 14% de los viajes será realizado por turistas musulmanes.
The same moment you are thinking about Muslim tourists, you are thinking locally, because you are thinking about all the Muslims in the world, and they are 25% of people, of population, world population, and they are they do the 14% of the trips, what they will do. 2020, 14% of the trips done by tourists.
Bueno, estos son otros datos. La previsión de gasto en el año 2020 es de 149.000 millones de euros. Es decir, son turistas que gastan mucho dinero. ¿Cómo es el cliente musulmán? Bien, lo más importante quizá a la hora de hablar de rentabilidad es ver el retorno que tenemos de la inversión. Es decir, si vuestro proyecto se comunica a través de las redes sociales o de, como sea, de cualquier medio a unos clientes, ¿cómo viajan esos clientes? ¿Y cuánto gastan? A nosotros nos interesa el dinero que se dejan en nuestro negocio. Sintetiza.
She has shown, also the expected expense of the tourists, and they used to spend quite a lot. And you have to see that 67% of Muslim tourists give importance to halal food, and 53% travels with the family, the 23% with friends, 90% with the wives, with their wives.
Okay, gracias. Con estos datos y partiendo de que los clientes viajamos como rezamos, Vamos a ver por qué es importante en el Islam el viaje. Me imagino que todos conocéis los cinco pilares del Islam. La profesión de fe, la oración, la limosna, el ayuno y la peregrinación. El musulmán tiene en su cultura absolutamente asociado el concepto de viaje como normalización en su vida.
It's very important to look at the five basements or pillars of the Muslim religion. It's the profession of faith, the prayer, the mosque. Now, the deep, the economic aid.
Fasting,
and the pilgrimage, the Hajj, to the sacred places, La Meca and Medina.
Si tienen esta vida marcada por el viaje, para nosotros es interesante poder, poder trabajar con ellos. Importante, los musulmanes tienen el Corán que les marca lo que es halal y lo que es haram. Halal es lo permitido, lo recomendable, lo ético, lo bueno, y haram es lo malo, lo despreciable.
It's important to look at these concepts. Halal means the right thing, the things that we can do, or a Muslim can do. Haram is the wrong thing, the things that they cannot or they should not do.
Okay. Por lo tanto, cuando hablamos de turismo halal, hablamos de turismo especialmente preparado para los musulmanes.
Then speaking about halal tourism, it's a tourism specially prepared for Muslim people.
Okay. Toda su vida está marcada por el Corán, entonces se aplica en la alimentación, se aplica en su economía, se aplica en la moda, en la cosmética y en el turismo.
Halal goes beyond the food, that is what we have always a connection, food and halal, but it goes to the cosmetic, it goes to finance, it goes to tourism.
Okay. Hay que tener en cuenta que con la globalización tenemos muchos musulmanes que viven en zonas, en países muy ricos y también en países emergentes, que esos son nuestros posibles clientes.
Muslims live in rich countries and in emerging countries. These are our potential clients for halal.
Por ejemplo, esta mañana estábamos viendo, voy a pasar algunas cosas, estábamos viendo en alguna de las presentaciones que han hecho los alumnos, hablaban de Booking. Bien, os invito a que miréis Halal Booking, que es una web específica para el concepto musulmán. En esa web, todos los hoteles o, digamos, resorts o instalaciones son halal, son especiales para ellos.
It's very important, as Booking is an important network for tourists. We have halal Booking, it's a network for Muslim tourists, and only places taking account these halal tourist premises are there in this Booking.
Por ejemplo, en el caso de España, hice antes de venir, antes de ayer, cuando estaba preparando la presentación, hice una búsqueda de todos los países que estamos aquí. En el caso nuestro, nos interesa especialmente el cliente musulmán. Y nos interesa porque es rentable, porque tiene dinero. Pero, ¿qué le interesa al cliente musulmán de Europa, de España, de Extremadura o de Cáceres?
She has searched in this halal booking, our countries present here, Spain, Italy, Greece, and she says in the case of Spain, we must be interested in the halal tourists, but why?
Y nosotros ofrecemos gastronomía, fútbol, clima, seguridad, el legado árabe, litoral, compras y dos cosas más que no están puestas aquí, que son caballos y halcones. Son apasionados de todo eso.
We offer in Spain all these things that Muslim tourists are interested in, like astronomy, football, climate, good climate, good weather, security, the Arab legacy, heritage, the coast, mostly the luxury harbors, and
shopping, caballos.
Shopping,
caballos y
horses and falcons and birds, falcons.
Exacto. Bueno, en el caso de Cáceres, por ejemplo, tenemos el aljibe, por supuesto, el jamán y el museo, esta casa árabe que no la he encontrado, o sea, no la he visitado, pero que esto lo ofrecemos desde aquí, ¿no? En el caso nuestro.
Not going very far, we have here in Cáceres the jamán.
¿Y qué estamos haciendo a nivel empresarial? Es decir, ¿qué hace el empresario español para conseguir captar clientes musulmanes? Pues veréis que esto es lo que os iba a contar antes. Antes de venir a Cáceres hice una búsqueda de cuántos establecimientos había en Halal Booking de todos los países que aquí estamos. En Grecia sí que hay, en Italia hay uno nada más cerca de Venecia. No he encontrado ni en Bulgaria ni en Polonia. Y en España teníamos en 2014 el primer hotel y ahora mismo tenemos 11 establecimientos. Estos datos son de fecha de antes de ayer. Casualmente en Marbella, Madrid, Barcelona y la Costa Brava.
Very interesting the findings in Halal Booking. We don't have in Bulgaria, we don't have
en Polonia.
We have just one in Italy.
¿Y en Italia?
In Venice,
cerca de Venecia.
Close to Venice. We have in Spain 11 establishments in Halal Booking. The first one was in 2014.
En 2014 el primero, sí.
2014 was the first one. Now this data is from yesterday. We have 11 establishments in these places, Marbella, Madrid.
En Inglaterra también hay alguno, pero como dos o tres nada más. Y hay muchísimo en Malta, bueno, lo podéis comprobar, hay en Estados Unidos, en la costa de Florida, o sea, poco a poco se van incorporando como oportunidad de negocio, ¿no? Porque es un cliente que se mueve con mucha facilidad entre continentes y que no le importa, tiene dinero, no le importa gastar.
It's growing as a business opportunity, as you can guess, because we have countries with nothing, and the client, the tourists, halal tourists, have money and don't care about crossing continents, etc.
Por ejemplo, el día 6, la semana pasada, fue el final del Ramadán. Ahora mismo, los musulmanes españoles con dinero están de vacaciones, porque es el momento en el que ellos celebran como la máxima fiesta.
It's also convenient to know their agenda. Their holidays start at the end of Ramadan. It was last week, so now Spanish Muslim.
Yep.
Spanish Muslim are in holidays and are traveling touristic activity.
Esto es importante, para calcular el final del Ramadán, como se celebra por meses lunares, hay que calcularlo dependiendo del movimiento de la luna. Es decir, que el Ramadán acaba aquí más tarde que en Indonesia, para hacer la planificación estratégica. ¿Okay?
As Ramadan is calculated with moon seasons, we have Ramadan before here, like Indonesia.
Yeah.
And so it's important to know that people in Spain, Muslims in Spain, are before holidays than Muslims in Indonesia.
Uh-huh. También en el caso de Halal Booking hay otras formas de buscar en otras webs, pero en esta específica que hay de Halal, ¿no? Hay también un proyecto de ciudades Halal y también se está creando una asociación de Medina. Digamos que estamos en el inicio del turismo Halal en España.
They are starting to appear some projects like a network of halal cities or a network of Medinas.
Y yo creo que el turismo halal puede ser una alternativa para la mayoría de los proyectos que se han presentado por la mañana. Evidentemente, los que son de peregrinación católica, no. Pero aún así, por ejemplo, cuando esta mañana escuchaba la ruta de la Plata con el camino mozárabe, aunque no seas católico, se puede unir con el legado histórico de ellos y puede ser una oportunidad de negocio, yo creo.
It's very interesting to think about pilgrim routes as an opportunity also for halal tourists, like the Mozarabic ways. It's a way to approach both Christian pilgrims and Islamic or Muslim pilgrims.
Y yo creo que se pueden organizar rutas específicas, por ejemplo, en algunos de los proyectos que habéis presentado esta mañana como oportunidad, una ruta especialmente halal. Únicamente se necesitan certificaciones. And the most important thing, open mind, of course. Porque si no tienes apertura de mente como negocio, puedes tener una certificación, pero evidentemente consideras que son clientes no interesantes, ¿no?
More important than certification is to have an open mind and mind consciousness about halal and about Muslim customs.
Y ya está. Yeah. Muchas gracias.
So we can dedicate a little bit to the debate if you want, and after we go for a coffee, a little coffee at the break. Someone, David.
Question. Okay.
I just want to say thank you very much. I thought that was very interesting. Just as a clarification, I think at the beginning something which I thought was a little misleading was you started with 1.6 million Muslims.
1.600 millones.
Yes, 1.6 million, right? The billion, 1.6 billion.
Millions.
Not millions.
Millones, 1.600 millones.
1.6 billion. Billion, billion.
No.
In English terms.
No, son 1.600 millones.
1.600 million.
It has to be 1.6 billion. If it is a third, you said it was
1 million. Sí, sí. Is 1 million.
Okay.
Okay. I think it's
Okay, fine. Anyway, it's a very big number.
Yeah?
Yeah, a very big number. And the thing is that what I was thinking when I was doing that is, if I was traveling to a Muslim country, would I like to be classified as a Christian tourist?
Yeah.
There is such a thing as Christian tourism. And Christian tourism means born-again Christian, like in the United States. So there are tour operators who are specialized in Christian tourism. And Christian tourism means tourism for people who believe very strongly in the resurrection of Christ, in all of those things. And I am culturally Christian.
Me too.
Yes,
I am Christian.
But I am not a Christian tourist.
Yeah, me too.
Okay. And exactly. So
mainly
my classification was that the people who are concerned about the halal things is a subsection of Muslim tourists.
Yes, of course.
As I say, if you go to somewhere like Beirut, for example, you will see people from Indonesia, you will see people from Saudi Arabia, you will see people from Turkey, and they have very, very different customs,
yep.
very different expectations, and so on. But it was just, I just thought it was important to classify that,
yeah.
so that we don't have the impression that sort of Muslims are a coherent group,
yeah.
but all have the same, all have the same expectations.
Of course, of course. Please, Martín, comentale. Evidentemente, en marketing hablamos de público potencial, que son los 1.600 millones, y el público objetivo, que es la gente que se identifica con Halal y que viaja. Que si estamos hablando de 3.000 millones de católicos, no todos van a Fátima. Eso está claro. Y segunda cuestión. En España ya hay una agencia de viajes que organiza viajes Halal. Pero no significa en absoluto que todos los musulmanes lo usen. Por supuesto que no.
David, she was referring, of course, to the potential market, but knowing perfectly that the segmentation, what, how she started, one-on-one segmentation, there are many different, exactly, as you said, different halal segmentation, applications, customs. And there is an agency now, the first agency, Spanish agency,
mm-hmm. Exclusivamente. Y tenemos una organización que hace certificaciones, que es un sello de calidad que se llama Instituto Halal. Se está trabajando en un proyecto Halal Europe. A ti. Que se está trabajando en un proyecto Halal Europe.
It's a project called Halal Europe or about Halal Europe.
Okay. Y luego hay otra oportunidad de negocio que no es halal, pero que es personas que quieren una vida, por ejemplo, sin alcohol. Es decir, turistas que van a un lugar que saben que no hay alcohol. Que eso es interesante para padres con niños, por ejemplo. ¿No?
Non-alcohol tourism is good for halal tourists. Also, for example, for family traveling with children and the ones in context
El año pasado, cuando estaba Ramadán, yo estuve en el hotel Alanda de Marbella y me sorprendió cuando llegué porque ponían los sellos de certificación y en recepción te dicen: usted tiene que saber que está en un hotel halal y que no servimos ni cerdo ni alcohol. Todos los clientes que había, salvo dos familias, eran europeos con niños y gente vestida como nosotros, disfrutando de Marbella. No problem de nada no. extraño.
Last year it was hotel, at the front desk, they say to the clients, we don't serve alcohol, we don't serve pork. And she was surprised by it because the people apparently in the hotel, the clients, were not pushing like Occidental families with children.
Mm-hmm.
More questions, more comments? We go for a coffee then. Let's go for a coffee.
Vale.
No groups now. We go everybody to the end of the corridor to the cafeteria.
Has dicho que tenemos 15 minutos de descanso.
Yes, 15
minutos.
Sí, más o menos.
Lo cuadrado el tiempo.
Bueno, estupendo.
No,
no,
iba pasando.
Pero muy bien, muchas gracias, Pilar.
De nada.
Me ha parecido muy interesante.
Gracias, es que al traducirse tarda más. Sí. O sea, si tienes tiempo para contar,
claro. Claro. No, pues es verdad que me parece muy interesante porque hay veces que nos cerramos mucho en un mercado muy definido y yo creo que sí, pero es que es una potencia impresionante que están ahí.
Sí, no, nadie ha dicho que te van a cerrar los 1.600 millones, pero con que vengan 100 al año.
Bueno, a ver, ¿cuántos vienen de otro?
Acaban de comprar, no sé exactamente en qué pueblo, una cabaña de corderos bestial. ¿Sí?
Sí, bueno, yo conocía la mayor parte, pero el remate estaba muy bien, porque les di
dices a ellos, oye, que de vuestro país no hay, ¿no? Entonces, claro, que le da, busquen, le da, que le den una vuelta. Nivel, la
claro,
nivel,
claro, que es interesante.
Que han comprado una cabaña y yo soy de Teruel, ¿vale? Y ahí el planteamiento también puede ser más o menos igual.
¿Tú?
Tenemos jabalí. Sí, bueno, vale, pero es que tenemos cordero que fallará. Y tenemos cosas muy reales.
Claro.
Y tenemos legado y sobre todo allí no abre la mente tampoco, ¿eh? No te creas que se ve. Y además siempre hay el tema de, bueno, y aquí han sido discretos, pero la pregunta que subís es, ¿usted no cree que los musulmanes tienen que adecuar cuando vienen aquí? Vamos a ver, no es todo lo que a la chila, vale, me interesa el de Qatar,
claro,
el que viene con Qatar Foundation que ha comprado el Barça.
También miren los ingleses y no se adaptan a lo que tenemos aquí, sino que nos destrozan.
Pero los prejuicios son enormes.
Claro. Pero me parece increíble que tengan menos
conocimiento. Solamente hablo de esto, yo no me puedo hacer como...
Además, pues
vengo,
es que yo
vengo a contarte cuando quieras en tu clase si urge, si, claro, si necesitas.
Pues que dice, oye, mira, es que se abre mucha posibilidad de negocio. Un sitio como Extremadura, que tiene mucho cordero, que pasa la rica mojara y que no sé qué. A ver, eso es
bueno,
que tú cierras.
Claro.
Así, de momento tú puedes conseguir las certificaciones para plantearlo como...
Con que tengas un poquito de sensibilidad,
claro,
es suficiente. Porque en vez de ser, o sea, es tan fácil como que a lo mejor no necesariamente...
We will go at 8 at the municipal hostel to have dinner, and we will go by car. The people that have a car can take some people in the car, and we will walk also, the ones that don't fit in the cars, but the cars will come back to take those that are walking. Anyway, it's a 15 minutes walk from here to the municipal hostel, not very much, they hardly out today that it's not so hot, but we will try to take you all to ride or whatever.
Okay, then we will now start the last session of today, and we again have three speakers who want to share their experience with us, with the, most of all with the entrepreneurs, so that they can create better projects, so that they will have successful projects in the end. So now we are going to listen to our Greek partner. She is Afroditi Kamara, and she will tell you yourself what she...
Yes, I'm going to give an old-fashioned presentation, no fancy picture, because it's more theoretical and a few, it's like advice, what I have to say. And my topic is a cultural enhancement as a means for touristic empowerment of regions and entrepreneurs. I need to explain that I'm a cultural heritage management consultant and a historian by background. And this, of course, will affect what I have to say. It's about perspective, not a purely touristic one. Traveling for recreation is not yet another product that consumers buy and use out. After the mass tourism fashion of the 70s and 80s, more and more people seem to realize this and to seek genuine cultural experiences for their precious free time. Based on their experience, knowledge, special interests, etc., more and more tourists seek to make the most of their trip by combining sightseeing, physical activities, local gastronomy, hobbies, etc. Contact with locals and learning how to appreciate local culture is a major point. There is thus a shift towards what has been called experiential tourism. We heard a lot about that today anyways. Cultural heritage, both tangible, that is material, and intangible, immaterial, of a certain region or country, plays an important role in the process of offering the potential of deepening the traveling experience and bringing visitors in contact with the real spirit of the local people. Historic towns and settlements, traditional architecture and archaeological sites create a unique environment with a very strong character. They arouse the visitors' interest and they help them evade from an often blunt and stressful daily life. On a deeper level, they constitute a challenge for further reading, learning, and discovery, thus a challenge for self-development. Aspects of local music, local gastronomy, traditions, customs, and rites contribute to the sense of delving into another culture, which can sometimes be a healing procedure for the tired souls of modern people. However, one needs to stress here that the cultural experience created has to be genuine, and to conform as much as possible to the precedent set by large international organizations such as the UNESCO. The NARA document on authenticity, for example, eloquently explains a series of reasons why and how cultural heritage has to be enhanced in order not to lose its authentic character. Particularly in respect to intangible cultural heritage, a line has to be drawn between genuine expressions of an ethnic or social group and the reenactments, that is the revivals of aspects of the past for reasons of collective memory or social belonging or even touristic exploitation. What we've been, I don't know how many of you were yesterday in Houston, the person who was talking there was presenting a lot of reenactments like that along the cultural route of Charles V. On the other hand, however, a purist and a strictly scientific approach cannot be valid either. Monuments and cultural heritage need to be preserved for the people to enjoy and learn from. Cultural heritage managers and consultants need to take the visitor's dimension in consideration when they get engaged in a project of cultural heritage protection, restoration, and enhancement. By this, we don't mean that they need to make choices palatable to all, but rather to realize that the monuments will play henceforth an important role in promoting local and national culture. Cultural heritage cannot be defiled or transformed into a kind of product. Yet products, particularly new touristic ones, can be developed into close contact with heritage aspects of a specific region. In this respect, the cultural enhancement of region needs to be well planned, attempting at addressing multiple aspects, or at least envisioning to do so. Restoring monuments which can have a character of landmark for a specific region or culture, and which can contribute to the creation of a certain cultural atmosphere is essential. The built environment constitutes a basic element for heritage interpretation. In the case of religious and thermal tourism in particular, historic churches, monasteries or baths are definitely crucial for the creation of the local identity. In fact, the restored monuments themselves can be the target of tourists who, although not religious themselves, are attracted by the historicity of the site and the spirituality they emanate. Highlighting the cultural landscape and tracing itineraries and routes is another important aspect of heritage interpretation, as locals, in this respect, help visitors discover the main assets of their region. Taking a step further, cultural routes, which may or may not correspond to actual itineraries and routes, are essential for creating a sense of purpose as well as a sense of deeper understanding of the cultural aspect of the past. Be it a personality like Charles V that we saw yesterday, or an activity, a moment in collective memory, for example, a war, etc. These actions, along with working towards supporting local products, both of an agricultural, gastronomic type, and of a small industries, artisans type, contribute essentially to what we call now branding. Local and regional branding is indeed a complex process. It becomes, however, more and more important for attracting experiential tourism, as well as for empowerment of local entrepreneurs and producers and the support to low-key business plans. In order to be successful, this process cannot be unilateral. It requires the close collaboration of many people, representing various interests, capacities, and regions of economic and social life. In order to be successful and long-lasting, this branding has to be stemming from the genuine character and potential of the region, and not only from the visions of some managers. If one compares the technological and touristic achievements of Dubai, for example, with Emirates, to the management plan of the historical thermal city of Bath, one understands easily what I mean. You know, one is more exuberant, the other is more based into the local tradition and evolution. Furthermore, since our focus here is on entrepreneurs, it should be stressed that local businesses, as well as inhabitants, civil society organizations, and representatives of the state and local authorities, are all considered as stakeholders in an effective and successful management plan. Young entrepreneurs in particular should always claim their role in this process, as it is not always the case that part of the management is confided by the state to the private sector, while on the other hand, they should prove their ability to think and act in a constructive way, following the basic precepts of sustainability. Entrepreneurial activity in relation to cultural landscapes, cultural roots, and cultural heritage in general should always demonstrate a deep respect of the materia prima, the first material of what constitutes the local identity, and be willing to maybe sacrifice some part of gain, of financial gain, in order to better protect heritage aspects. It's high time that a constructive dialogue starts in many parts of Europe regarding the bridging between entrepreneurial initiative and sustainable long-term preservation of what constitutes the values and spirits of heritage. As cultural managers, we insist on creating consensus. In this effort, we sometimes feel like Don Quixote de la Mancha, since we're in Spain, running after an unattainable goal. Quite often, social tension is so strong that successful implementation of management projects with the participation of stakeholders is almost impossible. Our constant advice, particularly to stakeholders of the private sector, is not to appear competitive, but to challenge the originality of their ideas, and to work hard on justifying their ideas and plans in terms of the general benefit, and not only respect to business entrepreneurial success. Participation at European-funded projects can actually be a very good practice for the collaboration between public and private sector. Until 2013, such a collaboration was limited, but the new 2014-2020 framework, however, has marked the change of tide and has opened the way to private institutions and companies, as well as to the civil society, to enter fields that until recently were considered purely academic. Last but not least, I'd like to stress that recent EU policies are very supportive to the notion of cultural enhancement. Networking, introducing modern technology, and incubating new business ideas is the focal point of many EU-funded projects, such as Cultour Plus, the one we're working on. Tracing cultural roots is also a prerogative and can form the substratum both of successful communication and collaboration, like the one we described to us yesterday, but also of successful proposals for funding. Clearing one's ideas on what to manage and how to manage is a very decisive step forward. However, it has to be emphasized that pure enhancement is not enough, and this is something that the EU authorities have to reconsider. By ceasing to support infrastructure work through programs such as the Interreg reform, and by shifting responsibility for this to either the stakeholders or the local authorities, particularly at a regional level, one runs the risk of having magnificent ideas for enhancement or regional activities, great publicity, and yet, at the end of the day, face damage and neglect of the actual sources of heritage. My last point is related to raising awareness in local societies. The public, the local inhabitants of the historic cities or the regions with cultural interest, can be the best ambassadors to their own embedded values. Yet one notices that this is rarely the case. Through our case study on the historic city of Chania in Greece, we established that the hardest resistance to the implementation of effective cultural management is exercised by the shop owners of the old harbour, who can't comply with rules aiming at the protection of the aesthetic and cultural integrity of historic settlements. The only way to reinvent tradition, according to my favorite historian and Hobsbawm, is to teach younger generations and help them imbue into values and reappreciate their past and identity. In this respect, research is more important than the theme. Every cultural heritage management project has therefore to be based on a solid and interdisciplinary academic platform. Thank you very much.
As Afroditi said, a very traditional speech, but with a lot of very concrete practical advices for the young entrepreneurs. One of the themes she thought is very important is branding. And the next speaker, Luis Ochoa and his group, will deepen this topic of branding. So now it's to Luis to do this presentation.
Afternoon. I hope you are not going to sleep with my speech, because we live in this siesta, following the tradition of my grandparents, should be siesta, but it's okay. Afrodita said something very interesting about branding, and I will not make too much of my speech. We are trying to speak about the turning point of place branding management. The paper that is going to be published is written by Gilberto Marzano. This is an Italian professor, and Luis Ochoa. We are from two different universities, from Poland and Latvia. Not to make too long, we can say that in the last few years, the majority of marketers have come to share the point that in a globalized world, place branding strategies are indispensable for increasing the competitiveness of nations, regions, provinces, and cities, and for attracting business. Of course, this is very important, And place branding is more than public relations, you know, and more about the image. Is something in this global market is something like make better the marketing and place promotion. You got the phenomenon of place branding is generally considered as an organic process of image communication because it's new technology, combining marketing strategies and governance objectives that are aimed at motivating investors and tourists. You got more or less image communication, you got marketing strategies, and you got the objective is to have more investors and tourists. You got the media, both traditional and the new media, play a remarkable role in place branding, of course, this is important. And now with internet that is cheap, you can brand a place very easy. Because you can use films, you can use multimedia, music, you can just determine a place reputation and image. I mean public relations. New technologies and the internet are changing the place branding. Before it was just offline, and now it's everything online. And the travelers, the internet communities offer the opportunity to present places in a way that transcends mere advertising, because place branding is more than only advertising. And you got in the paper, you got everything very well explained. Now it's very short. Social networking has completely transformed people's social lives, because before you used to buy some newspapers and find some information about a city. Now you sit in your computer and you search for a place and you know more about the place before going to the place than if you are only in the place. And for example, if I need to find a hotel in Barcelona, you don't have to go to Barcelona to find a hotel. You can sit in your home and you can just find which hotel is coming first, and you can have the insight of the place. The research has two aims, two questions. What is the impact of social networks on place branding? Do social media really satisfy the expectations and habits of tourists? And if you want to have the real answer to these questions, you have to read the paper that we brought. We had three important places. We did some internet research about Riga, that is the capital of Latvia, Częstochowa, Udine, and Castellón de la Plana, more or less little, but not much. That's why I said three plus one. We searched information in the travel sites like Wiki Voyage, TripAdvisor, Booking.com, and Lonely Planet. There are some people that said, no, I do only Booking.com because it's more, a lot of people use it. But TripAdvisor also is, for me, I like it. And Wiki Voyage is, of course, is very important. We got some information that with the literature review was undertaken from the SAGE journal database. You got the numbers. I will not make you tired. We have the same that we did before. We Google the. We got that the content may differ depending on the language, of course, because we choose Italian and Polish. And the most interesting thing is that the content plagiarism is widespread. No problem. There are no difference. If you are a researcher, if you are a professor, you are a businessman or something like that, no problem, but the plagiarism is very, very, very common. in all the information that you can find on the internet. Virtual answer to the most of the questions posted can be found on official websites, of course. Because you got also some places that you can find the comments of the customers, but the official website is always the place to refer to. There are habitual users who like to offer their advice, of course. Social media, we got to the conclusion to make easier. We are pursued that to exploit the huge amount of data available on the web, it will be necessary to invest in representations and models that are able to manage that data. And thank you very much. I hope you.
Okay. Thank you, Luis. And talking about branding, talking about selling your destination, one of the techniques you can use very concretely is storytelling. And that's the topic of the presentation of Francesco Zaralli, who is from Italy. He also told me that he will let us see two small videos during his talk to give us an illustration of what storytelling can really mean. This is it. He's preparing.
Hi again. I know you're all tired and like the audience seems to become even like there are a few people, a few survivors, so I'll try to be short and efficient as I can. So basically what we will refer in this section is storytelling technique, digital storytelling than corporate storytelling. Why we're going to step into this, because we are going to examine this tonight. We're going to see a way of telling something and to tell reality around and then promote reality around in a way. And then the corporate storytelling is the latest stage of our speech, of my speech, and is referred to the enterprise, and we'll see how. So starting from the general principle of storytelling, we can say that always people have been telling stories. So we are surrounded by stories, and we try to gather the stories and then try to live according to them. So you wonder why my association, you probably wonder why my association is dealing with storytelling. Because as we're going to see, mainly storytelling has been done to engage people and to create the empathy among people, sharing values, sharing the contents, and linking. So our job, which is mainly preventing the early dropout, training people, and trying to spread, in a way, the Erasmus program, the chances given by the European Commission and the chance to be trained out of the institution, as well as be get an orientation in a job, we use these techniques to tell and hook the people to get closer to us and to enjoy this and take part and enjoy this route. So basically, we said, storytelling is it's always been real, but in the latest 20 years, and there is it has been shaped the concept of storytelling as we find it nowadays. Basically, in USA, it has been done with the purpose of achieving certain objectives, as I was saying. So create empathies with the customers, for instance, tell the about project, tell about our goal, and then it takes the base from a changing of the reality and the changing of the equilibrium in our current situation. So it marks the change from a state to another. So, as I was saying, the story are always referred to reality, to something, to someone, in a specific space and time. They are, have always a context, and they make the sense. With the sense, I mean, they create the network, they create the bonds between people. Stories have always a main characters, an enemy, a magical object, but also are the hero can be hidden in every one of us if we read about stories. In fact, nowadays, some values are driven through fiction films. Everybody of you probably have seen Game of Thrones, or through Detective, or other fiction, really popular. They are made to bond us and then make us identify in certain values. So, what are our story made of? They're made of words connected to images, which are driving ideas to us, and therefore emotions. They make us bright and be passionate for something. They make us identify. Then, as I was saying, it starts from an equilibrium, from a change of situation. And the important part is the technique we use to people. Most of the time, how we start telling something matters, because a good start keeps us still reading, keeps us still informing and being interested in something. And it provokes a reaction, questions. So the reader should be always interested in what we're doing. So here is an example to what not to write and what to write. In the first sentence, for instance, after the first line, we already know what's going on, so we will give up reading. In the second one, there is a kind of suspended situation, so we are trying to wonder what Mary is going to do of her life. So, at the beginning and then the way we tell a story is really important. So once again, we have to inspire others. We have to make the story understandable and then think about the story and organize it. We create parallel words in it and for sure we engage the others. These words to engage the others is going to be really important when it comes to consider the corporate storytelling, because we have to engage the others through values connected to our products. So, what changed during the times? So nowadays, the storytelling is driven through the social media. So the social media basically are cutting the big stories. So what we communicate is in pills. So it's short sentences, short stories, and so it comes the micro narration, as it says in the slide. And the presence, so the means, the internet changed this way, the way to create stories. So everybody of us is potentially a teller this way, because we can use the social media to tell ourselves, describe ourselves to the others, tell the others our value, and then create the bond between people, which is not necessarily like selling a product or trying to communicate a project. Nowadays, the visibility, the quality visibility we have through the social media make all of us to set networks easily compared to the past. It should be. It's in a way, also according to the different social media, it changed the way we tell our story, because there are several social medias based on images, text, the blending of the two, the places. So according to the way we use the story and we put them together, or how we plan our story, split in images, location, venues, and text, we create an image of us. So this image, this is an example of a platform who helps the tellers to gather the stories and tell precisely what they want to tell through different sources. So it can happen during our telling, our inspiration is going to end, so we don't know what to write. So the only way to overcome this is still keeping trying, putting together something on paper, and reading and deepening our interest on something, reading, brainstorming, talking to the others in reality. So the creative writing, in a way, is a way to express ourselves. And it helps us to keep the track of our experience, to share the experience with a target group. And this is really important for the corporate storytelling. And it makes us free to express ourselves more or less without limit. So, why is it useful? Because it brings new ideas to the world. It helps us to expose ourselves. And creating a story doesn't mean exposing ourselves personally. We can talk to people through a built story, but which is partly representing us. So it changed the other people and influenced the other people. So the role the tellers have, this is a crucial point, is to connect the reader, the audience, the tellers, and to cluster it and make a network. So as I was saying, the storyteller tells something, some values, not straight away to the audience, but through a story. So as I was saying, the storytelling is connected to emotion, it creates empathy, understanding, tolerance, and so on. We have to identify the characters, fell in love with the stories, and so on. It helps us to spread our voice. The actual role of writing is crucial. We have to keep on exercising to improve our way to communicate and express ourselves or the story we want to tell. It's not an improvisation, but it has a specific structure. So a story could be split and released in different moments, but it has to follow a kind of storyboard and not lose its sense, lose its pathos, we would say, or its emotion on the way. So here there are some available tools online if you are interested to have a look. We are not going to explore all the links, but the slides will be all available, so you can study a little bit more on your own and then surf the net. So to the last tips are, of course, the story, your first writing, or the first writing won't be perfect, but through creativity and exercising, you will get better and not be afraid to expose or tell something. And it's fortunately, in the use of social media has enabled us to better overcome the behavior, the character. So if we're close people, or we tend to not tell or to not open to the others, through the filter of the social media, we are more pushed to, encouraged to do so. So when it comes to talk about corporate storytelling, all we've been saying before, it's going to be swapped into the retailing of product, and is the P of promotion in marketing. But the promotion comes is the last bit of a long process, which includes how we target the customers. So according to our target, we have to set our story and tell exactly what we want to show to our customers and which are the values they will be interested in when they're going to buy our product. So the planning has a crucial role, and the marketing marketing mix during the process of business development has a crucial role. So we have to create the identity of our enterprise, target it, then using the storytelling tools, communicate the value of our product. And who we are is another content we can share. So another point is to make it precise, direct, and the people should understand, recognize, and understand which is the difference between our product and the others. So it's partly the storytelling process help the branding process. So here is, I'd like to show you some examples. Basically, when it comes to consider the best example in storytelling, we can mention Lego Movie. The brand Lego has spread its values. Then we are going to reach the point of the tourism and the cultural management. But among the five best examples, there are the Lego movies. The way the UK Energy Agency was communicating, telling people, raising awareness of the consumption of electricity, the transforming cold data into a story. Or the Losing Nemo film. Everybody knows, especially the one of you who have children, you know the film Losing Nemo. Losing Nemo was done not just to make a brand or make a business around the fish, but it was made to tell people what's happening with the fishing, the wild fishing. So how important it is to preserve the biodiversity, also the techniques applied by the Coco Chanel brand, who were addressed to make of the founder of Coco Chanel a kind of legend, a myth. So film were released, and all the process of telling the profile of Coco Chanel were applied to promote the style connected to the founder. This is the funniest one, actually. The Old Spice, who's an aftershave make, it wasn't talking directly to men, it was joking with women, saying, come on, if you look at me, the guy says, if you look at me, you see the ideal partner, so probably your partner, smelling like me, will be like me. So we're gonna watch a little second of it.
Hello, ladies. Look at your man. Now back to me. Now back to your man. Now back to me. Sadly, he isn't me. But if he stopped using lady-scented body wash and switched to Old Spice, he could smell like me. Look down. Back up. Where are you? You're on a boat with the man your man would smell. What's in your hand? Back to me. I am. It's an oyster with two tickets to that thing you love. Look again. The tickets are now diamond. Anything is possible when your man smells like Old Spice and not a lady. I'm on a horse.
This is really clever, actually, and it has different, of course, different episodes. Always playing on humor, let's say, to the funny fact of this man telling, "Come on," and with this product comes all the luxury. What you want to be, what you want from your partner. So another example. Going to the touristic promotion. So the most interesting example of the effect of storytelling is the weird case of Miravete della Sierra, which was a dying town. It basically had just 12 inhabitants, all 12 really old, and the town was disappearing from the map
Nobody wanted to go there or be there or just cross it. So a marketing and advertising company called Shackleton LTD, which is a Spanish company, decided to push the to see which were the effects of the storytelling campaign, telling the town and pushing on the value of the tranquility of a nice quiet place of the province of Teruel in the region of Aragon. So the effects were amazing because playing on the fact that the tranquility was translated into a funny thing. So you know, everybody gets bored if hear the sentence here doesn't happen anything at all, anything. No cars, no phones, no internet, no barely electricity, barely water. There's nothing. So it was good because people were looking for the quietness of the country, the countryside. So they started to push this this claim, which was el país donde nunca pasa nada, more or less. And what came out was an amazing result. More than 1,350,000 views, then 300 downloads of the contents from the website gadgets. The story of the people were pushing the town to grow, and then the population rise from 12 to 50 stable. And then a lot of hostels, rural houses, and enterprises were born in that town, which counts during the high season a high number of citizens who go temporarily there. So it's reborn in a way. So it has been mentioned by national TV, international magazines. So this is a little habit, and I'm going to close my
speech. En sus apartibles calles no hay coches, no hay semáforos. Bueno, de hecho no hay nadie. La hora punta es la compra del pan. El tiempo no pasa y adelantando la hora. El acontecimiento más importante del año fue el cambio de luz de Acre. Aquí nunca pasó nada. Y a ti, ¿cuánto hace que no te pasa nada? Ven a mí a decir, www, el pueblo en el que nunca pasó nada, .com.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm trying to not bother you and get you bored because it's the last speech. But I'd like to keep in contact in case you wanna just brainstorm and then maybe shape your idea around this technique. So find out more. There is Mattel here, Elder. There are a lot of in the project, a lot of people in
the sector of marketing, communication, and advertising. So it will be great if we can share this experience together. Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Okay. We still have time for a little discussion. Is there anybody who would like to ask something extra to Afrodite, Luis, or Francesco?
How they are so effective to move people. writing is really a quality very rare as working people to have this capacity of improvising verse. So I think these two are really brilliant qualities for storytelling. Francesco has spoken about writing and the process of creativity, so the creative writing, but also the process of creative making verse. I would take it as a different storytelling technique. And the third one is really to engage the people that are in the scene in the verse. This is what really makes the difference and makes the effect in the people that are there. So, for example, I've seen this in the traditional chant in Valencia, the traditional chant in Levante, and all the people ended crying when they were in the verse, the Estadores, where they don't tell the story but sing the story in this case. The story is two or three operas, two or three songs. So this applied to corporate storytelling could be also very powerful, very, very powerful. I think, and for me, and for cultural managers in some way, I'm very interested in promoting and rescuing these qualities in the storytelling, nowadays, storytelling. So I think we have to think about that also, to try to educate also in making verse, improvising verse, and having this sense, this is the fourth quality that I was talking to, for example, to give what we call in Spanish una decal, una de, to give a positive point to someone, but also something a little bit negative, a little bit like a joke, and after a positive. So it's this context. These are two qualities very interesting for the storytelling technique. In this case, talking about culture, that's going to be incorporated storytelling.
Thank you, Martin, for this contribution. Another meaning of storytelling, a storyteller, and what he does. Anybody else would like to share something with the group? Or anyone else who has a question for the speakers? If not, then perhaps we will close this session. I thank you all for attending. I hope you have learned something through the speeches this afternoon of all these experienced people. I hope they can inspire for certain the entrepreneurs with a better formulation of their projects. Do feel free to integrate techniques as branding, as corporate storytelling, in order to make something successful of your project. That's what I would like to say. I suppose Martin perhaps wants to finalize it in a more formal way. Or
no,
then we go off the air. And
no, I am very glad to see still quite a good number of people here. I know the ones that are not here is because they have to make some talking, and so it's very intense, the program. I understand that not everybody can attend to all seasons, but I'm very glad about the journey of today. I think we have learned many things. We have seen very interesting communication. We have known that it's very important. We have known better, because we knew already something about the business projects of our entrepreneurs. And Cultour Plus entrepreneurs are every day a little bit more our entrepreneurs. So I hope that we do good networking, that we know people for our business, for our professional by Tories and desires. And now, just logistical things. We have some places in the cars. We organize in the outdoor how to go to the municipal hostel. And if we have to do two trips, we will do it. So in the gate, entrance gate, we will organize the cars.
Okay.